Hello and welcome. My name is Tom Lemmers. I'm a product manager on the identity engineering team. In this video, I'm going to walk you through the process of configuring an enterprise application for user provisioning. So let's get started. To start off, I've navigated to portal.azure.com, and I'm going to navigate further down into Azure Active Directory, and then once more into enterprise applications. This pulls up the list of all my currently configured enterprise applications, but today we want to go and actually create a new application. So in the upper left-hand corner, you can select New Application, which pulls up the Azure Active Directory App Gallery. This is the gallery of all the applications that currently have SSO or user provisioning enabled. So today we're going to look to configure user provisioning, so I'm going to go and add a filter specifically for that. And the application we're going to configure is Adobe Identity Management. So if I click on this title, it pulls up the option to modify the name. If you want to do so, you can modify that here, and once that's done, you can click Create in the bottom left, which will actually go and create the application in the app gallery. Once the application has been successfully created, you will be automatically redirected to that app, to that new application. From there, you can go and click on provisioning, and then you can go and click get started. And here we'll swap out the provisioning mode from manual, which would you manually go and create these objects in the target application, and we'll instead go with automatic, which is the users will automatically be provisioned over from Azure Active Directory to your target system. So here you can see we're prompted with credentials, and these are the credentials that we'll actually be using to communicate with the target system. So here it's asking for a tenant URL and a secret token. So I'm going to go and copy in my account URL and paste that in there. And I'm going to do the same thing with my token. And next I can click test connection here, which it'll go and actually validate that I can communicate with the target system. It'll use the URL and the secret token I just entered to go and communicate with the target system. Once I've done that successfully, I can click save in the upper left-hand corner, which saves these credentials to the application. And this actually goes and exposes a few more settings down here. So let's go explore those. So we expand these settings options, and then we can see the scope here is currently set to sync only assigned users and groups. The other option here is sync all users and groups, which would go in and provision all users from your Azure Active Directory to your target system. But for our sake, we're going to use the sync only assigned users and groups. So what this means is that if we take a step back and go out to the users and groups section in the enterprise application, we can go and actually assign directly users or groups to the application, and these will be the users that will be users or groups that will be provisioned over to the target system. So for our case, we'll go and select a single user. We'll select this user, Aiden, and click assign in the bottom left. And now if we were to go enable provisioning, this would be the single user that would be provisioned over to the target application. So let's make our way back to the provisioning blade in the Azure portal. Clicking in here, we can see that the view has now changed slightly. We now have some options at the top, like start provisioning, stop provisioning. You can also restart provisioning and also edit provisioning, which would just take you back to where we were previously. But let's explore the rest of this blade first. You also have the option to provision on demand, which is a really useful feature, especially when trying to troubleshoot users, or if you just want to provision user information over without having to wait for the next cycle to complete. You can specify a specific user here and then click provision on demand, which will sync that user and that user only. Moving back, we can also see information about the sync cycle itself. So in this case, our cycle hasn't actually run yet, so it's not completed yet. To get similar information, you can also take a look at the provisioning logs. Provisioning logs will show you what's actually been provisioned over to the target system. This is also a great spot where you can troubleshoot this, so you can combine the power of the provision on demand feature with the provisioning logs itself, and you can use that to analyze to see if your mappings might be wrong or where you might be actually exactly running into issues and take a step back and address those in the application itself. You can also see some provisioning details over here. This is mostly for advanced troubleshooting. If you have to contact our Microsoft support, this could be useful in that situation. But yeah, let's take a look back in the edit provisioning section now. As stated previously, once you've gone and entered the credentials in this portion of the setup configuration here, you're really at the point where if you want to use the out-of-the-box configuration, you're able to go and do so. All you really have to do is specify the scope of users that you want for provisioning over down in this setting, like we did just now, and then you can go and enable provisioning, save it at the top, and then your provisioning cycle will start to run. And you'll be able to see this in the upper right-hand corner that this has gone successfully configured now. You'll see the positive confirmation in the upper right. However, if you're looking for more of an advanced configuration, you can actually go into the mappings here for users and groups and modify some of the attribute mappings as well as adjusting some of the scoping filters as well. So we'll focus on just user mappings for this scenario, but you can do essentially the same exact thing with groups as well. And so we'll click into groups. Here, we're presented with the attribute mappings. On the left-hand side, we have the Azure Active Directory attributes, and on the right-hand side, we have the target Adobe attributes. So let's take a look at given name specifically. So here you can see that the given name in Azure Active Directory will be mapped to the name in the target system. If the application you're configuring is missing a mapping, or there's a mapping you consider necessary for your business function, you can actually go and click Add New Mapping at the bottom, and then you'll be presented with an option to add a new attribute. It'll pull up a set of drop-down menus, which you can use to configure a new attribute mapping. In this case, source attribute is going to be a list of available attributes in Azure Active Directory. Let's say we want to take a city, for example, and then the target attribute is going to be the target attribute in the target system. So we could specify whatever attributes are available in this Adobe system. In this case, Adobe Head doesn't have too many additional attributes that aren't mapped by default. But for this example, we'll just click email alias. So the city value of the user in Azure Active Directory will now be mapped to the target attribute. Email alias is in the target system. You have to click down here at the bottom and then save in the upper left. But now this new attribute mapping has been added. It's been solidified. It's now part of the configuration. Lastly, there is an option to configure additional scoping filters. So under source object scope and then all records, if you click here and then add scoping filter to the top, then we're given the option to create additional scoping rules. So these rules will scope in objects from Azure Active Directory. So let's create some logic and try and figure out what exactly that logic would do. First, we can select the target attribute. Here we'll say city, and then we have to select the operator. In this case, we're going to say equals to. And then we have to specify the value that we want the operator to be equal to. So in this case, we'll say NYC. So the logic here states that in order for a user to be considered in scope, their city attribute in Azure Active Directory needs to equal this value of NYC. And then we can save this. You can go in and we can also add additional scoping filters as well. So these would be considered, these will be evaluated with AND logic. So I can say if a user is, their city is NYC and their department is HR, then they're in the scope of the application. You can also negate these as well. In this case, we're not going to go any further here. Scoping filters can get very complex. If you have something in your mind that you want to do with scoping filters, it can be done. But in this case, we're gonna stop here. So we can go ahead and exit out of this. And essentially, once you've gone through and actually entered your credentials, your application is good to go. Everything we've done since, besides the scoping portion of this, is kind of just modifying your application to fit your business needs specifically. But really, once you've gone and entered those credentials and set your provisioning status, your application will start provisioning to your target system and should be all good to go. And remember, you can use the provision on demand feature in unison with the provisioning logs to help you troubleshoot or identify issues that you might be receiving in regards to mappings or your scoping filters and so on. Thank you for taking the time to learn about how to configure user provisioning, and we'll see you next time.